The posthumous opening voiceover sequence of Billy Wilder's Sunset Boulevard is one of the most famous monologues in movie history. I'm leaving Los Angeles on board the Coast Starlight, and I feel like Katharine Hepburn in David Lean's Summertime.
What is it that we need in an ending? Tied up plot lines, evidence of some meaning behind the story, a moral, a punchline, a suicide? Frank Capra had a lot of suicidal protagonists in his films. It's a Wonderful Life opens with Jimmy Stewart trying to kill himself by jumping off a bridge on Christmas Eve, and then has a soft-spoken angel show him the significance of his life via an extended flashback depicting what the world would have been like had he never been born.
It's against the law to commit suicide around here.
Capra, a conservative Italian Catholic Republican, once summed up his religious agenda as a filmmaker in these words: I have two motives in making any picture. One, to entertain. Two, to present a Christian doctrine. A lot of people don't know this, but in the original story treatment for Frank Capra's Meet John Doe, the Gary Cooper character actually did commit suicide in the end. In April of 1940, when Capra and Robert Riskin got their hands on Presnell and Connell's version, they headed off to an adobe bungalow just outside of Palm Springs to make their own changes to the script. Shifting the story toward a more Christian tone, they moved the suicidal appointment from the 4th of July to Christmas Eve, and decided that he wouldn't actually jump in the end. In their search for an ending, Capra and the film's Jewish screenwriter Robert Riskin turned in desperation to Jesus. In the final, unbelievably melodramatic scene, Barbara Stanwyck pleads, "Oh, John, if it's worth dying for, it's worth living for. You don't have to die to keep the John Doe idea alive. Someone already died for that once, the first John Doe."
"And he's kept that idea alive for nearly 2,000 years. It was he who kept it alive in them. And he'll go on keeping it alive forever and always."
I think of Alfred Hitchcock's Vertigo as a sort of cinematic ode to nostalgia. It's a cautionary tale, really, about the pull of the past and the futility of striving for things that are unreachable, precisely because they only exist in the long ago. "Where do you go? What takes you away?" Scotty asks Madeline as he tries to uncover the mystery of her attraction to the past. A question we might also ask of Scotty, as his obsession deepens in the latter half of the film, and ultimately of ourselves as well, as Vertigo succeeds in bewitching us under the same spell our protagonists endure. Early in the film, Scotty goes to meet his old friend Gavin Elster at his shipyard office. Out the window of the studio set behind him, we see the rear projected image of the cranes at the San Francisco dry docks down at Pier 70. "The things that spell San Francisco to me are disappearing fast," says Elster, voicing a perennial lament clearly as old as the city itself. In Vertigo's original screenplay, in a lengthy reflection removed from the final shooting script, Gavin Elster gives an impassioned description of the siren lure of San Francisco and its impact on his wife. "You know what San Francisco does to people who have never seen it before," Elster begins. "All of it happened to Madeline, but with such an intensity as to be almost frightening. She had to walk all the hills, explore the edge of the ocean, see all the old houses and wander the old streets. And when she came upon something unchanged, something that was as it had been, her delight was so strong, so fiercely possessive. These things were hers." One of the main reasons I'm so attracted to landscapes and buildings is the sense that, unlike people, they tend to endure for many generations. They possess an intimacy with the past that no person, however old, can approach. I came to San Francisco with no special affection for it, and then, of course, I fell in love. In some kind of poetic, cinematic justice, as the city possessed Madeline, I possess it in return.